This is the MV Golden Ray, a ship that went from a multi-million dollar asset to a billion-dollar environmental threat in a matter of moments. You see, the MV Golden Ray wasn't your average ship. It was a massive car carrier, 656 feet long and weighed 20,000 tons. On December 8, 2019, it capsized in the St. Simons Sound off of the coast of Georgia, carrying over 4,000 vehicles from sedans to luxury cars. With such expensive cargo, how could a ship like that suddenly capsize? What was the weather? Maybe a strong tide? The answer actually lies in one individual's silly mistake. According to the National Transportation Safety Board, the main cause of the wreck was the chief officer's error in entering wrong ballast quantities into a stability calculation program. Basically, instead of calculating to ensure that the ship's ballast was properly balanced, he entered numbers that made the ship think it was more stable than it actually was. Just like a small nudge in the wrong direction can make a Jenga tower topple over, the ship inevitably tilted, and this meant stakes far beyond monetary value. The ship was an immediate and long-term environmental threat. To start, the MV Golden Ray had 24 fuel tanks, all almost full when capsized. And what do you think would happen if that many tanks, over 300,000 gallons of bunker and diesel fuel, just sat there? The risk of a spill was crazy high. If that wasn't enough, the cargo itself, thousands of cars loaded with potentially hazardous materials like battery acid, engine oil, and coolant, were a danger to the ocean's ecosystem. Ever heard of the butterfly effect? The St. Simons Sound, a region rich in marine biodiversity, could potentially face severe damage to its waters and wildlife. And with that, local authorities that relied on fishing and tourism would also suffer. At this point, the U.S. had only one option, and that was to reduce the risk and potential damage as much as possible. In a mission that required careful planning and a commitment to both the safety and protection of the environment, and more realistically, the wallets of the corporations that stood to lose in the catastrophe, the U.S. began what would become the largest and most ambitious ship salvage in its history. And it was easier said than done, because how do you lift a monster like the MV Golden Ray from the ocean floor without causing any more chaos? It couldn't simply be towed out of the ocean now, could it? Nor could it be lifted out. Instead, engineers came up with a plan that had worked for many years in shipyards but wasn't ever really considered for a catastrophic event like this. Why don't we just cut the ship? Cutting the ship into 8 massive sections while removing each piece individually was the best method to minimize risk, and this meant using a custom-built diamond-encrusted chain designed to slice through steel and reinforced hull materials. The stakes were high. First, the St. Simons Sound is notorious for its strong tides and unpredictable currents, making precision work difficult. Then there was the structural instability of the capsized ship itself. Each cut had to be meticulously evened out to ensure the remaining sections didn't shift or collapse. But cutting the ship into pieces was just one step. How would they be removed from the water afterward? They needed something strong enough that could lift thousands of tons at a time, introducing the VB-10,000. A heavy-duty crane that became the center of the entire operation. The VB-10,000 stood over 250 feet tall, a twin crane that was specifically modified for the Golden Ray mission. It was capable of lifting up to 6,800 tons in a single go, and became critical for safely lifting each section of the ship onto barges, which are flat-bottom boats used for transporting heavy or bulky items. They usually lack their own propulsion system and are pushed or towed by tugboats. And so, the operation began. Together, the VB-10,000 and the diamond chain turned an impossible task into a step-by-step process. Each lift and cut brought the team closer to success, but a fuel spill remained a constant threat throughout. But what would even happen if it spilled? The fishing industry would ground to a halt. Tourist trips canceled because the beaches are covered in black sludge. The first step was to remove most of the ship's fuel before cutting even started. At every stage of this operation, they had to ensure that the environment was protected, and to do this, they developed a bunch of different environmental safeguards, including specially designed containment booms, simply floating barriers to surround the deck. But how would these floating barriers even stop liquids from spreading in a body of water? Well, if you've ever mixed oil and water together, you know what happens next. The ability of a substance to float or sink in water depends on density, which is how much mass is contained in a given volume. You might think that oil is more dense than water, and although it is thicker and stickier, it's lighter per unit of volume and tends to float on the top. Do you see why the booms were important now? The booms worked great, but extra safety measures were taken. Frequent tests, like regular water sampling, were done to measure contaminants in the water. It also monitored changes in the water quality, including oxygen levels, pH, and turbidity, the water's murkiness. All of these told operators how healthy the ecosystem was. Once all the samples were collected, they were sent to labs for detailed chemical analysis. Their results guided response efforts like deploying more contaminant booms or skimmers, special devices used to remove oil or other floating contaminants from the surface of the water. Then there were the underwater drones. These were remote-operated vehicles, or ROVs, and were used to inspect the wreck and its surroundings for leaks or damage. The ROVs provided real-time visuals and data to salvage teams without the need to put divers at risk. The drones were equipped with high-resolution cameras, sonar systems, and chemical sensors that could detect oil plumes or cracks in the hull or debris. Some drones even had sampling arms to collect water or sediment samples directly from the ocean floor. All in all, the drones played a huge part in the operation's success. Yet even with these precautions, the operation was about to run into challenges that would test the technology being used. To start, you need to understand the ship's reinforced steel hull. The MV Golden Ray's hull that was designed to withstand the harshest ocean conditions became one of the biggest obstacles. Though specific details about the MV Golden Ray's hull materials and construction are not publicly available, it is reasonable to assume that the hull was constructed from high tensile steel, common for ships of its time. We can also base this on general characteristics of roll-on, roll-off type vehicle carriers and standard shipbuilding practices. Let's have a closer look. The hull would have been box-like and wide, with a front bow that was slightly rounded to reduce water resistance and a rear stern featuring a flat area to accommodate the loading ramp. It would have a smooth, steel-plate exterior, most likely with a coating of anti-corrosion paint and reinforced with bulkheads and frames. Keeping its weight and size in mind, it's obvious that it was robust and imposing. The use of the VB10000 and such a large cutting chain proves that the hull needed substantial effort to dismantle. On top of all that, the weather wasn't helping much either. In the initial plan, they wanted to complete salvage before hurricane season, but they experienced delays. Whenever there was a storm, they had to stop. During the cutting process, though, is when all hell almost broke loose, more than once. The friction generated by the diamond-encrusted chain caused fires to break out on multiple occasions. This was alarming, not only because they posed severe risks to the safety of the crew or threatened to release toxic fumes and debris into the environment, but with the oil and fuel still remaining on the ship, there was also the risk of an explosion. So how did they fix this? They couldn't just have firefighters on standby the entire time. To counter these issues, the salvage team made sure to use heat-resistant equipment and also introduced strict fire suppression protocols. The VB10000's remote-operated cranes allowed workers to stay at a safe distance while continuing the operation. Even with all these setbacks, the team pushed forward, and eventually, this historical salvage operation was a success. But at what cost? After nearly 2 years of relentless effort, the final section of the MV Golden Ray was lifted from the ocean floor in late 2021. The end was near. This climactic moment marked the countless hours of planning, innovation, and hard work by a team of over 4,000 people. And let's not even get started on how expensive the operation was. Here's a simple breakdown. the salvage operation was one of the most complex and expensive maritime recovery efforts in history. From the engineering and planning to the specialized equipment, labor costs, environmental safeguards, and logistical support, it cost a total of $840 million. Was the cost worth it? And what about the ship? The MV Golden Ray was declared a total loss. With the hull and machinery and initial operation costs and insurance, a total of $62.5 million for the ship was lost. Then there's the cargo loss. You didn't forget the thousands of vehicles on board, did you? To refresh your memory, the ship was transporting cars from Kia, Hyundai, GMC, Mercedes-Benz, and the list goes on. Recovery disposing of the vehicles, many of which were damaged beyond repair, and the insurance claim filed by the car manufacturers for the loss of inventory cost a total of $142 million. Lastly, there were other minor cost-related factors. They had to clean up over 300,000 gallons of fuel and deal with fines and penalties. There were also costs of investigations by agencies like the NTSB and the U.S. Coast Guard. This brings the total amount spent to a whopping $1 billion, give or take. But what do you think? With so much already lost and such high expense, do you think it was worth the salvage? Bye for now.